get ready to like this and subscribe to it, please. Two parts today. The first is about thoughtful gifts. No plastic gifts, not using plastic. And hopefully I'm not too late for you on that one, but there's always next year. The second part is a little more serious, and it's about taking a different look at what you do at home. Just a different perspective. So, thoughtful gifts. A thoughtful gift you can give to someone you love is having them over for a Christmas tea party. That is very thoughtful, very fun. And we did that recently. There's a Christmas tea set. And I realized we were about to start, and I said, we don't have candles. And our guest said, oh, candles. And so we lit some candles and just enjoyed each other's company. And when that was over, we had the tree up, we had the house decorated, we had a few gifts bought, but I said, it's beginning to feel a lot like Christmas, having that tea party. So it's a very thoughtful thing you can do, and you don't have to make it difficult. You know, you can get inspired by Victoria's Christmas issue, but you can just use what you have and make little sandwiches. That's what we did, and we had a little scone mix, which I don't buy mixes, that was a gift. And so I added some chocolate chips to it. That makes everything perfect, right? I added some pecans. It was a cherry mix, and that was really good. And then, believe it or not, I thought, this woman has a baby. She needs strength. And so I got out some homemade soup. Doesn't sound like a tea party, but it was the hit of the party. It was like everybody's saying, yes, the soup is so good. So that's the thing you can do that is will make your Christmas memorable. And even if you just, like we did, we just had myself and my girls and one young woman and her baby. It was just such a treat for all of us. We just so enjoyed it. So special gifts don't have to be the normal thing. And, you know, we tend to spend more than we should, and it tends to be kind of a letdown where you feel like that wasn't that great. They could have bought it themselves. It wasn't meaningful. It wasn't thoughtful. And what really got me thinking about this was this necklace that my daughter Hannah made when she was 8, we think. And so when I got it out the other day, she said, I can't believe I ever thought that you should wear that. Well, I wear it and it makes me happy. And again, it's beginning to feel a lot like Christmas. I have homemade children's necklaces on. And so then there's the homemade bracelet that she also made. This goes together, right? So, you know, are the pearls that John got me in my ears more valuable than the pearls on this bracelet? Only monetarily, but that's not what counts. The thought is equal. They were both given in love. So, gifts given in love. So, I was just looking around. What can I give that people really actually like? I have this book I brought over from England, The Railway Children. I actually went to the place where it was filmed. And it's a one, and then I read it on the way home. It's this terrific story. And then when I got home, I rewatched the movie. I had seen that before, but I never read the book. So I thought, well, I will read this to the grandkids, maybe not finish it when they come at Christmas, and they can take it home. Again, feeling more like Christmas all the time. And then I was looking around, what do I have, you know, that not really using and all that. So I saw this stack of 6 red cups, perfect hot chocolate cups, and I thought, I can make a hot chocolate basket. And so I can put cocoa, almond flavor, vanilla flavor, you know, maybe some maple syrup, because everybody loves that stuff. This is getting to be a pricey gift, but it's thoughtful. Or whatever kind of sweetener in there, and then maybe some evaporated milk and some condensed milk, because a hot cocoa mix with the powdered milk is just not the same as getting something real in there with the milk. It turns out so much better. Maybe a little sea salt, so they won't forget that in their cocoa. And then, you know, add something, add a little. Here's your book to read, maybe this, while you have your Christmas or your New Year's hot chocolate or something. So something they could really tie to a memory and enjoy together. So another thing I did was I made a gift for someone. This is not the olive oil that came in this, I actually used my olive oil decanter because I have two. I tend to get wild when I see beautiful glassware, and I don't need to. They're just cluttering my kitchen. So I took this one and I put in rosemary from my rosemary that grows in my Trader Joe's coffee can. You don't have to buy planters. You poke holes in the bottom of it and put it on a plate, and there you go. So I put rosemary, put some garlic, bay leaves, peppercorns. Now you might want to do some research on how you really should do this and how long does it last and what to tell whoever you're giving it to. This is a gift that I think, oh, there's some sea salt on the bottom. They will enjoy, and it will enhance their cooking and their salads. And so I used what I had. So those are just some ideas that I had about making Christmas special for me, not just for them. I have so much more joy in giving something that comes from my heart and that I put some thought into, instead of, oh, get this done, order this thing on Amazon, be done with it. So those are some ideas. Now, part two. On thinking a little differently about what you do at home. If I were sitting in a cubicle somewhere, none of this would happen. I just wouldn't have the presence of mind. You know, this is because I had the time to declutter. And I had time to sit down and journal and put different people's names down and think about them and just kind of be in that flow of Christmas. So I was listening to a couple of teachings this morning, and one was very, very straight from the Word and very motivating spiritually. And the other one was, and I like both of these people, but the other one was very different, and it was about successful people. And this person named off these successful people, and you would know their names. And I thought, well, okay, they're successful financially because they're famous. We know that about them. And maybe you could say they're successful because they set a goal and they achieved the goal. But would I want any of these people's lives? Most of them, no. Most of them, no. I would not want their lives. Because their success is a self-focused success, and that is not success because there's no joy in that. There's no end to that, the demands of that false god of serving yourself. But I thought it was interesting that the mistakes that were listed here are mistakes, according to this teacher, that people make in not being successful. Too many goals, not writing the goals down. I'll come back to these. Non-specific goals. Don't assign yourself a deadline. Too comfortable, not stretching. Must put a demand on faith. Not visible goals. They need to be put in the planner, on your vision board. Speak them, look at them, call things that be not as though they are. And then I added some things to that list of six things. I added not giving thanks and talking the problem. And impatience. And so as I was thinking about this, I thought, you know, all this applies to raising kids. It applies to being successful in marriage. It applies to homemaking. Okay? So if you're trying to successfully raise your kids, you could have too many goals. You could have all these outside goals. And what you're doing as a parent right now, it requires to do it right, it requires focus. And it requires an understanding that you don't have anything else more important than this. And so they're not writing goals down, okay? You need to write this down, think about this, journal about this. What's going on? You know, for me, let's say I was trying to teach a child to read, and I was like, what is going on here? And I began to get into that mode of, okay, possible solutions. And then another mistake is non-specific goals. Okay, I don't want to say, okay, I'm going to teach this child to read. I want to say, I'm going to teach this child to love to read, and here's how I'm going to do it. And I'm going to assign myself a deadline. Now, that I don't think is such a good idea, because it's really easy to get into the world's way of thinking. You know, I did that. I was told by this scope and sequence from a curriculum, this child should be reading by 6 years old. And my son wasn't reading at 6 years old at all. And when I backed off, he just, at 6 and a half, he started, he was reading the editorial page in the newspaper. And that's a different story. I'd like to talk about that sometime, about teaching kids to read. I got a lot to say on that. But, so, you know, I can see that assigning deadlines has some value, but all I ever had to do was change my deadline because it was always too ambitious. So too comfortable, not stretching. We don't ever want to think it's going to be comfortable raising kids. You know, when you're sitting down, you finally get off your feet, that's when they're going to act up and you have to get up and deal with it. You cannot, it's not a comfortable job. If you're going to do it well, it will never be comfortable. It's not. It's going to stretch you if you do it well. And then non-visible goals. And, you know, you think of this as you put this in the planner, you think of goals as the world sets goals to do all these things. But what is more important than the goal of, I'm going to raise a child who loves God and loves his fellow man and loves life and is a wonderful contributor and lives out the purpose God created this child for? What could be more important than that? And that's worth writing down and keeping in front of your eyes. And it's worthwhile because when that child does something that is so not okay, you can look at that goal and say, wait, we're not doing that. This is the goal. So how do we deal with that? Because we have a great mission, great purpose beyond anything that what the world would consider successful. It's just, we have as homemakers, if we'll accept it, we have a higher calling, a better job, a higher life, a more joy-filled life, and it hits the mission like no other. And it shapes the entire world. And so even if you look around and think, well, what difference will I make? Your child and you raising that child in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord will change the world. Thanks so much for being with me. Please like and subscribe.